Did it live up to the third most, well, valuable company in the world?
Yes, thanks, thanks, Caroline. I'd say our main takeaways from Jensen's keynote yesterday is that the competitiveness of Nvidia's products is only getting stronger. Blackwell, the new platform that the company announced, offers up to 4 times higher training performance and 30 times higher inference performance than its predecessor Hopper. And so next time you hear someone announce a chip that's 10 times faster than Nvidia, remember that a year later, Nvidia will also have a chip 10 times faster. So alternatives to Nvidia can have an advantage that lasts at best one generation, and a year later, that advantage goes away. And last but not least, remember that this advantage often comes at a cost. First, giving up on the flexibility that GPUs offer, and second, the cost of not being able to leverage Nvidia's ecosystem. So I would say that yes, it lives up.
Antoine, there was a lot more emphasis from Jensen on inference than there has been historically, right? The story was around the role H100 played in training large language models with many tens or hundreds of billions of parameters. Are you convinced that if we're in a world where we move from more training to more inference, Nvidia continues to lead in that side of the market as well?
Yes, I think so. And I think Jensen clearly illustrated that very well. Inference is a very complex problem that involves very complex optimization, where you have to parallelize a workload across dozens of GPUs. And I think what Jensen showed yesterday is that NVIDIA's moat is really about being able to optimize these GPUs to solve that complex inference problem very efficiently. This 30 times better than Hopper clearly illustrates that that NVIDIA is very, very much delivering on that front.
What were you most excited about from Jensen, right? He's like being compared to Steve Jobs. He's the man of the moment. He wears his leather jacket. Are you convinced by all the things that he says about the future when he's on stage?
I think I was most excited about innovation beyond just GPUs. If you look at the fact that NVIDIA also announced material improvements for secondary chips, like the Grace CPU, the DPU, various networking chips, we actually can conclude that only half the performance improvement is coming from the GPU. And the other half is actually coming from the rest of the hardware stack and system level integration. So bottom line is that NVIDIA's moat is not just about designing great GPUs, it's about designing great systems optimized to unleash fully the capabilities of those GPUs. And I think that's really what I was excited about when I looked at the keynote yesterday.
And it's clearly perhaps why we're seeing some impact on rival chip companies. I mean, AMD is, I think, one of the worst performers on the day. Does this mean that they've got it all locked up? Or is with the new paradigm shift to inference and the fact some of these hyperscalers themselves want to be making their own chips, does that longer term provide some sort of competitive issue?
Well, I think that NVIDIA's competition will thrive as well because demand is so strong at the moment. So everybody will continue to buy as much as they can, at least until the end of next year. Mm. And that doesn't mean that they will challenge the dominance of NVIDIA, but that will make room for alternatives. So at this point in time, we actually see upside in both NVIDIA and AMD. But the uncertainty that there is beyond 2025 means that the risk-reward ratio is getting thinner and thinner as those stocks keep having a run. What happens beyond 2025, I think nobody knows. It will depend on the performance of next-generation larger models, as well as adoption and monetization of AI. But I would say that there is room for challengers like AMD to also gain a lot of share in that market. Probably in the 10 to 20% region is something we would see as reasonable.
I want to just dwell on the supply side issues a little bit, because packaging is something that's being highlighted time and time again. Are we ultimately going to see an issue, never with demand, it feels like, but just how much can be made, how quickly it can be made, and how and who buy?
So I think demand is really, you know, something that we'll have to look at. We'll have to look at many, many dimensions. We are on the lookout, you know, observing the industry on all fronts. And so we'll definitely keep you posted. I don't think at this stage anyone can determine what's going to happen beyond 2025. Between now and 2025, though, we have very strong visibility. All data points suggest that NVIDIA is going to do very well, AMD is going to do very well, Broadcom is going to do very well. We see the industry shaping up, you know, supply, CoWoS capacity, for instance, doubling again this year. I think all the data points suggest that everything is going to remain strong until 2025, but there is no way to determine what happens beyond 2025 yet. We'll have to monitor leading indicators on that front, as I mentioned earlier, like adoption and monetization of AI.
I love Caroline's question because Blackwell has 208 billion transistors in the tensor core, right? It's so many transistors, it's actually two chips in a multi-die format. TSMC is going to be the manufacturer making them, 4MP technique. Just something you said, Antoine, I think the forecast in fiscal 25 is $110 billion of revenue, up from 61 in fiscal 24. Do you have a good sense of how quickly Blackwell will be revenue generating? I think they said it will be launching later this year, calendar year.
Yes, I mean, when you look at NVIDIA's prior cycles, for instance, Hopper that launched in late 2022 represented maybe mid-single digits of sales and mostly in the fourth quarter. And that quickly ramped in 2023, maybe to about half of sales. And so we expect probably a similar trajectory to play out for Blackwell.